Hello, everybody. Welcome, welcome. We're going to just take a minute here and let folks get themselves situated before we get on and going. Obviously, it's not October 25th. It's November 15th. But it is the Disaster Housing Recovery Coalition's national webinar. So we're just going to give it a few more, maybe a minute and a half or so before we get on going. We'll get going in a little bit here. Cool. Yeah, so once again, this is the National Disaster Webinar hosted by NLIHC. As some folks are already doing, feel free to say hello in the chat function. As we go through today's agenda, Q&A box will be open. That'll be probably the best spot to throw in your questions, and we'll ask our panelists to stick around or at least keep an eye on that Q&A box after they speak so they can kind of go through and answer the questions that NLIHC staff cannot. And I'm still seeing that number of participants count up, which is excellent, but we'll get going in a little bit here. Cool. Well, I think we're good to get going. I'll just say a few words to welcome everybody. First off, housekeeping. Again, the Q&A box will be open. Just in case you're wondering, the flashes in front of me are not the paparazzi. That is the NLIHC staff photos being taken in front of my office. So obviously, the glass enclosed nerve center of NLIHC's HQ is a hum with activity today, which is good because we are also humming along with disaster recovery activity as well. Have an excellent call lined up. We're going to kick it first to some national callers and then drill down into some ongoing recovery efforts in Florida and then Puerto Rico. Again, my name is Noah Patton, and for folks that aren't aware, the NLIHC operates the Disaster Housing Recovery Coalition. It's a group of over 800 and I think 90 organizations at this point, working together to ensure that all disaster survivors receive the assistance that they need to fully recover. And so with that, let's go to our first national panelists, if they're cool with that. And that'll be Elvin Lauren Torres, Kate Bulger, Timothy Carpenter, all with Fannie Mae. So I'll let them go ahead and get started.
Thank you so much. I am Kate Bulger. I'm with Money Management International. And we work in partnership with Fannie Mae to provide service through their disaster response network, the DRN. Right now, we're serving consumers in Florida and Puerto Rico in particular who've been hit by hurricanes. But in the past, we've served people from many different types of disasters, hurricanes, floods, earthquakes, tornadoes, COVID in the past few years. And I'll say one of the things that we're seeing here right now in this current disaster is that consumers are really still struggling to recover from COVID. What we know is that, the consumer's starting point before the disaster is really where we want to get them back to if we can in recovery. And that starting point has eroded since the beginning of COVID. And so we're seeing folks who have less income coming into their home in the first place. They're less likely to have savings right now. You know, they are starting with a lower credit score overall than what we typically see and what we've seen in past disasters. And so with all of this, we're really concerned about the length of time it's going to take folks to recover. Elvin, do you want to talk a little bit about Fannie Mae before I just take off and talk exclusively about the DRN?
Kate, I think Elvin's having issues with his speaker. I'll jump in. I know he also had some videos that he wanted a screen that he wanted to share, or a slide. Thank you, Kate. Working together with MMI, Fannie Mae since three and a half years now, we've been running the disaster response network. We're ecstatic to see the help that we've made, having provided over 60,000 counseling sessions across the country. And for every disaster and every hardship, it's been a great service for people to be able to give them additional assistance, and it doesn't displace any local nonprofit. What we saw after events like Harvey, even a community like Houston that had a very vital housing nonprofit establishment, they themselves were down, and their people were down, and their operations were closed. And it takes a while to get that back up, but it also, the disaster relief counseling is a specialty. And your expertise at MMI, Kate, has been one of the keys. And I think one of the other keys is that every client that you counsel, you assign a counselor, an individual counselor to. And to me, that having gone through a number of disasters myself, it's so much of a relief not to have to retell my story each and every time, and not to get caught in phone purgatory and press this number and wait and hold. But just the work that you're doing is so great. At Fannie, we have about one out of every four mortgages in the country, and our focus for one out of every four single family mortgages in the country, and our focus has been on the community, not just on our mortgages, but if we can help after a disaster, the entire community come back. And that's been the great part about the disaster response network, is that we've been able to provide the service for everyone, renters, homeowners. They don't have to be Fannie Mae borrowers or live at Fannie Mae multifamily properties. But I'll let you talk more about it. It's a free service, and we'll certainly share links to the disaster response network with everyone. But Kate, have at it.
Awesome. Thank you so much. So Tim's absolutely right. So we do assign one counselor per person. And the way it works is consumers contact us. They can contact us online through Fannie Mae Know Your Options website. They can give us a call through our phone numbers, obviously. And what we do is immediately connect them with a counselor. And so in that first interaction, our main focus is to understand what they're going through, to get as much of their story as the consumer is ready to tell, and then to figure out really where they are in their recovery. So, you know, are they in a place where, like a lot of the consumers that we're working with today, they've applied for FEMA and they're just waiting to hear back? Maybe they've heard back and they've been denied. That's about 21% of the folks that we're working with today. They need help working through that denial. You know, but we work with folks who are really at all different kinds of places through the recovery. So it can be somebody who was impacted by Hurricane Michael years ago and are still struggling to recover, or they're suffering right now from the most recent hurricane. But once we know where they are, we really try to focus on where they are today and going forward. One of the big stumbling blocks we find for consumers is that they get really fixated on mistakes that they make early in their recovery. And so Maybe they don't turn in something by deadline, or they didn't upload all of the pictures that they needed for their FEMA application, right? And if we let them get stuck in that past mistake, it becomes incredibly difficult for them to move forward. And so we stay very focused on what are the next steps and what are really the three next steps. Because in a disaster, there are a million things pulling at people's attention, and that can be overwhelming. And so we focus on really what are the next three, maybe four steps that you need to take to get back to get on track and to move and take care of the things that are most crucial for you and your family, where you are in your recovery right now. And so that can be helping people with insurance, it can be helping people with FEMA appeals or applications. Sometimes this is helping people understand what's going on in the process. It can be really easy to recover. And so at the end of that discussion, that consumer is going to walk away with the most important things, the three or four most important things they need to do next. They're going to have an action plan that summarizes everything that they've got. It's going to be delivered digitally so they can always go back and take a look at it. And they're going to have a date and time for when their counselor is going to call them back next. And so what happens is our counselors really stick with that person up to 18 months. Where we continue to check in with them at least once a month. And typically the way it works out is it is much more frequently early on in the disaster when there's a lot of little things to do and a lot of big things to do. And so what the counselor does is say, okay, you've got this big step, this important step you need to take. You think you're going to get it done by Friday. How about I call you Monday morning and we can talk about how that went? And those check-ins are great because first they help consumers really stay focused. So they know they've got a call coming up. It is easier to keep that at top of mind and get through and get it done. But the other thing is, in recovery, like there are going to be setbacks for everyone, right? So they're going to make that call or try to do that thing, and it's not going to work out the way they expected. And getting, you know, having those inevitable setbacks can be really difficult for folks to move past. And so that counselor, by calling right then, right after the step, and continuing to follow up with them, it means that counselor can help them overcome it. So if they need to make a new plan, if they need to make an alternate plan, if that counselor needs to help the consumer make that call, maybe they were afraid to call their insurance and check on their status of their claim. So the counselor needs to help call, but their insurance didn't go as well as it was supposed to. And so the counselor is going to call back with the consumer and help them take that next step. But having a person there who's your, we like to say your toughest coach and your loudest cheer. Right, so they're there to help push you through your recovery and celebrate all of those little wins as you go, and it makes a really big difference. So again, they're sticking with that same counselor the whole time, you know. And what we see is after major disasters, the typical consumer when they don't have help and support and structure there, the average consumer is talking about 25% on their credit score. So this is really looking at low-income consumers in particular, median low-income consumers. They typically lose about 25 points on their credit score in that first year. With DRN, we're able to keep them from losing anything on their credit score, which doesn't sound like a huge win when I tell it to people that their credit score didn't change. But after a disaster, it really is a huge help. That credit score impacts, in a lot of ways, their ability to continue to recover. So if they're going to get, if they need loans to recover, if they have to pay something to rebuild, that can make a big difference. It impacts insurance for your property. It impacts insurance for your car. It impacts your utilities, right? Like, credit score is a big deal. What we find is in the 4 years following the disaster, consumers that work with us end up with about a 40-point increase in their credit score, which is really encouraging. It means they're in a better place than they were previously, which is ideally where we get folks to go. But we see a lot of changes. They make a lot of really smart financial choices as they're recovering when they've got that support of a financial expert. I also want to touch on one other thing that you mentioned. For us, it is really important for our program that we are a spoke in the wheel of recovery. There is no replacement for on-the-ground teams that are doing the million other things that it takes to recover. And so when we know that there is some kind of on-the-ground support or that where they're getting some other kind of support, one of the things we encourage clients to do is to share their counseling summary, the action plan that they get after they talk to us each time, to share that with whomever is on the ground helping them out. Because we want to make sure that Everyone's working together, that there's never feeling like there's any friction. And then we ask that the consumer tell us what's going on and what they have going on the ground as they're going through well, so that we can help that consumer focus on things that are supportive of that and not fighting against it. But I think I covered everything there too. Is there anything else?
Kate, you know, I'm the hundreds of thousands of people that have called the Disaster Response Network, not everybody needs to set up long-term counseling. And that's one of the things that I think has been so helpful. You know, if somebody talks to their mortgage servicer, to the people they send their mortgage payment to, and they say, you know, maybe you want to consider forbearance, but the consumer doesn't understand what forbearance is, just asking questions, a safe question, I think has been a huge help for those simple questions. Is this the right thing? What do I need to ask if I enter forbearance? How do I get out of forbearance? And talking through that with you has been important. And the other thing that we've been pushing and you've been helping us push is it's kind of funny when a mortgage company says, don't pay off your mortgage, but don't pay off your mortgage until you have a plan. Don't make those big decisions up front. If you pay off a 3% mortgage, and if you get that kind of insurance settlement, then going back and rebuilding and getting a mortgage at 7.5 may not work for that consumer. And so taking that time, forbearance, or just taking a break for a minute and not make major decisions after disaster until you know more information. You'll never know all the facts, but as much as you can before you make those big decisions is just so important. We don't need to have more people in a tougher situation moving from a 3% mortgage to a 7.5 if they can keep from it. And that pause and that wait and getting the facts is just so important after a disaster.
Absolutely. And I think one of the pieces that pause, part of why that pause is so important, is really the impact of trauma on people who survived a disaster, right? And trauma can get in the way of recovery. It can cloud decision making. It is difficult to remember things when you're really suffering and recovering from trauma. And so we really built the DRN and the service we provide from a trauma-informed approach. And part of that, like Tim said, is helping folks really take a beat, try and give themselves some financial space before they make those big decisions. To make sure that it's really what they want and it's not just a reaction.
Kate, I know we're running our social media ads, certainly in Florida and in Puerto Rico right now. As far as multiple languages, how do you handle that challenge?
Yeah, absolutely. So we have a team of English-speaking counselors. We also have a large team of Spanish-speaking counselors. All of our Spanish-speaking counselors are native speakers. I like to tell people it does not matter how much Duolingo I do, how much time I spend on there. They are never going to let me on the phones because I'm not a native speaker. But in addition to that, we use a language line that does translation with us for folks, and we can handle over 200 different languages with that service. So anyone from, you know, any culture, any language, we are ready to provide them support. And we have never run into a language that a consumer wanted that we weren't able to provide support for.
Great. Thank you.
Yeah.
Noah, I think I saw you jumping back up.
Yeah, I was in the nicest way possible. But no, you couldn't see me. I was, you know, nodding vigorously throughout this entire thing. And I think, Kate, you made an excellent point about credit scores and, you know, the importance of not drastically making financial decisions immediately following the disaster, and as well just talking about like the little things that can really have larger consequences down the road, and like how do you think through all those things. I did want to ask, so this is a, you know, excellent. And Tim, you stole my question about language access. So well done on that. But I was going to ask kind of, how does this interface, so we've all heard about disaster case management or DCM following a disaster, kind of how does that Is that different or similar to kind of these services, or how do y'all interface?
It's different. It is very, very different. So we really can only provide support for the financial piece of the recovery. When it comes to disaster case managers, they cover the entire gamut. Like, they are incredible experts in a wide variety of topics and can do all kinds of things that we can't, right? So I cannot coordinate for you when materials are going to be delivered to repair your home, right? They can often help with that, right? I am not going to find a child psychologist to help your children who are suffering from long-term trauma effects of the disaster. They can help with that. What we do in this case is provide that financial counseling, the financial support. And then again, we ask the consumer, you know, we ask the consumer during the session if they've already got a case manager. If they don't, and we know that there's already some infrastructure set up to either get on a waiting list or there's actual case managers that are already ready, we help the consumer, encourage the consumer, if they won't let us make the call with them, to get on that list, to get a long-term case manager. And then once they have one, we ask that they share that counseling summary. And you know, anytime we see any friction or the consumer doesn't quite know what's going on and you know, confusion, one of the big tools I feel like we have in our toolbox is tri-party calls. And so we'll make tri-party calls with their case manager. If their case manager is available, we do it with their mortgage company, their insurance, FEMA, all kinds of groups, but it really helps to have everyone on the same page. But I'll tell you, our counselors love to hear that they have a case manager. It's a huge difference.
I bet. Well, thanks so much to all of y'all for running this excellent service and for hopping on this call to talk to folks. I'll shout out Elvin in the chat. He put the link there. So y'all
listen. Can you guys hear me okay now?
You can check it out. Oh, yeah. We can.
Oh, goodness. Sorry about that, guys. Yeah, and I'll also share the flyers for Ian in English and Spanish. Noah, I'll share that with you for the distribution. You can share that with folks. And just wanted to add one more comment, if I may. You know, as Kate was describing, you know, the service in detail, Tim describing our role in it, you know, we really take a boots on the ground approach. You know, so for example, after Ian and Nicole, we were on the ground. We participated in a critical needs event in Port Charlotte. We spent the last couple of weeks meeting with folks in Fort Myers, in Lee County government, et cetera, just to let people know, hey, there is help that's available, right? And we want to hear. We want to hear what's going on, what's working, what's not working. From a financial standpoint, do folks need help connecting with their servicer, for example? A lot of people get scared and, you know, don't want to have that conversation when it's appropriate, but we help them do that. And that's part of what Kate's team does. So just wanted to share with folks some of that. And we've taken some of our own employees on volunteer events. We've taken, goodness, hundreds of employees to California, to Florida, to Puerto Rico. We've taken over 300 folks there up through the pandemic and looking to do some of that hopefully sometime next year. But we're engaged, we're involved, and we're in the community. Just wanted to let folks know that.
I appreciate that very much. I'm sure many all disaster impact communities do as well. So thanks so much to you all. I think there was just one Q&A in the Q&A box. If y'all could stick around just long enough to handle that. And yeah, thanks so much for coming on. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Cool. So from here, I think looking at our agenda here, we're going to move along to Madison Sloan from Texas Appleseed, just to talk about a recent report that they put together called But Next Time, Storm Survivors Demand Overhaul of Disaster Recovery System, which of course is what we're all about here at the Disaster Housing Recovery Coalition. So I will let Maddie take it away. I believe we have your slides booted up into this PowerPoint as well. There you go.
Thanks, Noah. I will say, this is not so much our work as it is the work of organized groups of disaster survivors who really came together across different states. Because I think, as we all know, survivors have a very similar and often negative experience across storms and across states and across you know, the country, including territories and tribal governments. Next slide. So these are some of the contributors and groups that worked on this report, obviously some Disaster Housing Recovery Coalition members, but again, really drawing on, you know, the experience of disaster survivors and their expertise in both what's wrong with the system and how to fix it. I guess next slide. So, I'm not going to go into every detail of the report, obviously, but I do think it's important to, you know, let folks know what the vision and values of all of these groups were, you know, which was letting survivors lead because they are the experts on disaster recovery, you know, centering equity. Disasters don't affect everyone equally. And if response doesn't affirmatively address that, those disproportionate impacts are continued and magnified, and we don't have an effective recovery without equity. Disasters should prioritize people, not profits, not furthering other kinds of policies that we have seen in many places, including, for example, you know, really displacing public housing residents. And that any kind of reform has to address the root cause, because these issues are structural. They require systemic reform, you know, not tinkering around the edges, as important as those smaller individual changes may be. Next slide, please. And one of the things you know, that folks really wanted to emphasize was that, you know, there are specific communities and specific families that are always hit worst and first by climate disasters and remain on the front lines of those disasters. And that, you know, we use this term because it is inclusive. And those categories of folks who are on the front lines and who are hit worst and first are broad and obviously intersectional. Next slide. So there are five major recommendations in the report. One is, you know, get money to people faster, including both immediate assistance, you know, helping people with their immediate and urgent needs when a disaster hits. You know, folks recommended looking at some of the direct assistance programs that the government used during COVID to get money to people in disaster impacted areas faster, making you know, programs and application systems work better and move money faster, including making CDBG-DR a permanent program and cutting out those delays between temporary and permanent assistance. You know, recommendation two is equity. Our system currently leaves some families and communities out, treats all communities the same instead of looking at where the greatest damage and the greatest need is. I would say it would be nice if FEMA could take a lesson from MMI and actually have translation available, for example, for folks with limited English proficiency. Recommendation three, you know, the flood insurance system is also broken. It is just unaffordable for too many people in highly vulnerable areas. you know, when Congress reauthorizes flood insurance, as they hopefully will do, they need to include more protections for low-income homeowners, stop the inability to afford flood insurance from preventing access to other kinds of assistance, and rein in some of the abuses in from private insurance companies that are administering these programs. You know, recommendation four, mitigation. You know, we have historically, the goal has been build back the way it was before, and we can't do that anymore. We have to be doing mitigation, you know, not only as part of disaster recovery, but on a broader scale, not proactive and not just responsive. And recommendation five, you know, the reform has to, again, it has to be systemic. You know, our entire disaster recovery system is simply not structured to deal with the current reality of climate disasters and climate change. And we are, we're, you know, we're out of time to make those kinds of changes. Next slide, please. So the, you know, the overall purpose of this report is to provide a roadmap that's based in the expertise and lived experience of disaster survivors. And, you know, we all hope that this will be a set of reforms that, you know, survivors come from across the country can coalesce around and support, that advocacy groups can support, and that, you know, policymakers and government agencies can use to make these systems more equitable and effective. You know, again, this is incredibly urgent. We have to find the political will to make these transformations and to stop the most vulnerable people in this country from being left out and in fact pushed further into poverty and put further at risk by how our system works. Last slide, please. So this is links to the report itself. The title of the report comes from a podcast called But Next Time, which looks at the experience of disaster survivors in Houston after Hurricane Harvey and in California after the wildfires. It's great if y'all have not listened to it. I am happy to answer questions, or if, you know, folks are interested in connecting, you know, with the network of people who really wrote and supported this report. I'm happy to facilitate those connections, although a number of them are actually on this call. So I will leave it there. Thanks, y'all.
Thanks, Maddie. All exceptionally important points. Since we just have like a minute and a half before, we should probably move on to folks working directly on the ground. I guess, so I'm wrestling with what question to ask here. I guess, you know, I'll take the normal interview question of, was there anything in this report that surprised you when working with all these groups from a variety of places across the country?
Unfortunately, I can't say it surprised me because it's how similar the experiences of people who've been affected by multiple different disasters, multiple different kinds of disasters, and over you know, decades. This report was released for the 10th anniversary of Hurricane Sandy, the 5th of Harvey and Maria, and the 1st of Ida, and, you know, really in the midst of Fiona and Ian. So we were not only looking at, you know, 10 years of problems across multiple states, but we were literally seeing those problems happen again in real time in the response to Fiona and Ian.
Well, thank you so much, Maddie. I appreciate your work as always and the work of everybody at Texas Appleseed and everybody involved in writing this report. We'll stay in touch and go from there. So I think, it's like historically large scale FEMA reform, disaster recovery reforms have often come at the cost of, a lot of human lives and catastrophes and that sort of thing. But it's just important to harp on the fact that it need not be that way, and we don't have to wait around for the next complete catastrophe to push for systemic reforms. And speaking of, current issues, I'm going to throw it over to Gladys Cook, who's Director of Resiliency and Recovery at the Florida Housing Coalition, to talk about how Florida is doing in the aftermath of Hurricane Ian.
Yeah, thanks, Noah. Hi, everybody. Good afternoon. The butt next time kind of reminds me of what we're calling Hurricane Ian, which is the storm that arrived too soon, because all of us housers in the last 3 years of Blue Skies have been working so hard on mitigation and resilience and talking about replacing older mobile homes and fortifying homes and finding low-income people in floodplains and getting their homes mitigated. And so then we just had this catastrophic hurricane that I'm just going to start with some numbers and then a few items of status and what's going on. So there were about 900,000 FEMA registrations, and the status of where are those people now, 625,000 of them are home. And they either got to stay in their home or their home was repaired. And so that's kind of the good news. There's about 226,000 who are in hotels, motels, mostly with family and friends, RVs, campers, or some kind of new temporary rental. And the most critical part is there's 18,419 that they call emergent. And it means they don't know what they're going to do or where they're going to go. But 3,000 are in their vehicles, 1,068 are sleeping at their workplace, 3,700 are still in mass shelter, 7,600 are homeless, 2,000 are in churches or houses of worship, and 919 are still in tents. So while it's good that so many thousands are back home, the hardest part is yet to come. And that's sort of how we feel now, because as the dust settles, you can really see how bad the damage is and what we're going to have to deal with. So there's about 2,700 households that are in what we call FEMA hotels, transitional shelter assistance, and they can stay in those for up to 6 months. They have to re-up every 2 weeks, but there's about 300 participating hotels in Florida, Georgia, and Alabama. And you see in the news, I couldn't find a hotel, or it's too far from work. And so that happens. It doesn't work for everyone who's eligible for that. We are seeing good occupancy throughout the participating hotels. And FEMA rolled out what they call non-congregate sheltering, and that is RVs. And there's FEMA RVs, and then there's the State Division of Emergency Management mobile units. But right now the FEMA ones are coming. They were massing them in Fort Pierce and Fort Myers right before Hurricane Nicole, a tropical storm Nicole. So that interrupted everything. They had to actually close the joint field office of FEMA. So it was a big interruption. But two of those RVs were set yesterday in DeSoto County. So we know that there's a pathway for that. And the main purpose of those is if your home is damaged and you cannot live in it, you get an RV in your yard, and then you can live there until it's repaired. The FEMA RVs can stay there for up to 18 months. So it's home, and it's where people can be while their homes are getting fixed up. If that doesn't work, they can put these RVs in commercial parks, and they've inspected or 300 of those and approved less than 100 finding empty lots, spots for those RVs. And then that it's always possible to do a new park with RVs, the so-called FEMA village. And that's definitely not off the table. It just hasn't been set up yet. So they also opened up two other programs for multifamily housing. One is the direct lease, where landlords are work directly with FEMA and have those, and they'll rent them to survivors. And then the interesting one is called the Multifamily Lease and Repair Program. It's not a new program, but it's where FEMA will pay for damage repairs if the landlord will then rent to survivors. And I believe FEMA pays that rent as well. But it's a it could be a win for damaged multifamily properties. It's a little harder with the assisted, and we're going to try to find what's wrong with that and see if we can work that out. But speaking of our assisted inventory in Florida, there was some surveys done, and this is just some of the report. There's 1,974 damaged units that are inside of 998 buildings. There's one catastrophic damage, so that property is completely gone. But there's only 30 displaced residents, so those extensive ones didn't have, they were smaller properties, okay? That's kind of a difficult thing because we always look to our assisted housing for people to live, low-income people to live after a storm, but Florida has never caught up with that. Before this storm, we had a shortage of 2.1 million affordable units. It just makes it even harder. A couple more numbers. Only 9.6% had flood insurance, and only 36% of, and these are the FEMA registrants, 36% had home insurance. So home insurance continues to be a big problem that we need to solve. So just on to other things now. Last week, FEMA went out with their solicitation for case management services, and that is to go along with the RV program, the non-congregate sheltering, and it's so to help people who are in this type of shelter to develop a housing plan and work toward solving it. And that's really welcome because after Hurricane Michael, it didn't come for over a year. And Hurricane Irma, the same thing. And to have this come out so quickly is really encouraging. And then I have to shout out to Fannie Mae. They always have case management. You can always call the Fannie Mae Disaster Response Network and get a case manager who will actually talk to you. That's really helpful for that. So getting to our state housing providers, we have our local governments, we have a state housing trust fund in Florida. And so we've been working with about 40 local governments who will be getting some of those funds. Well, there's six counties that will get the Hurricane Housing Recovery Program. And that money has to be appropriated by our legislature. And it could be December, but it's probably going to be their regular session. So that money won't manifest until June or July, but it will be sufficient to come into those housing offices to pick up where they are because they're going through the funding that they have on hand right now. But they've been doing emergency repairs and roof repairs and things like that all along. But our governor pointed to having directed that 5 million of our disaster funds be used for paying insurance deductibles. And so that's very helpful to the SHIP administrators because they can help with that. If FEMA doesn't pay for insurance deductibles, but this funding does. So we're trying to find these matches where what one doesn't pay, the other one will. I think that's it for that type of information. I was in Fort Myers also week before last, and this is just, I don't have any data on it or anything, but you know, I kept stumbling upon these mobile home parks, and one of them, it just it had really, really old RVs, and they'd had like 2 feet of flood water go through. And I just have a feeling that it was probably undocumented workers living in there. And there was probably 200 trailers, and those folks don't get a FEMA number. They don't get any kind of assistance, but they're the ones that are helping rebuild our communities. And so I just hope that the charities can get in there and help with that situation. So I saw some questions come in. I'll try to find some answers for you.
Thank you, Gladys.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, as always, super important. I did just, we're a little bit short of time, but just very quickly. So those numbers that you had cited at the beginning, where did they come from? Because that is very useful. Those are very useful numbers to have.
We're so lucky. I didn't even mention this, but the Florida Housing Coalition is co-chairing the state disaster-led housing recovery task force. And that's a FEMA requirement. FEMA told Florida, you will have a state-led biweekly housing disaster housing recovery task force. Okay. And we're co-chairing it with Florida Division of Emergency Management. So we are getting numbers. We get to see the daily reports that come out. They're not anything embargoed or anything, but they just come across. And so we get to see those. And so we that's where we get the numbers. It's from FEMA. They have daily status reports. But the task force, just if I could on that, you know, we used to have all these 20, 30 agencies all doing their own thing. And now all of them are on this task force, and we've only had a couple meetings, but they are now talking to each other, and we're going to build a plan together without having to go around and outside. But we do a survey monkey before their meeting, their biweekly meeting, and say, what's going on? What's good? What's bad? And we're getting incredible information. It's almost forming a database of the story of what's being experienced and what the solutions are.
Man, that's so useful. Cool. I look forward to seeing at least a portion of that database.
Sure.
Ongoing, for sure.
Okay. Yeah, happy to help in any way. Thank you all so much.
Thank you, Gladys, as always. From there, because we are a little short on time, just going to throw it right over to Veronica Gonzalez, Litigation Coordinator and Community Attorney at Ayuda Legal, Puerto Rico, to take it away.
Oh, hi, Noah. Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes. We gotcha.
Thank you. Hi all. Ariadna apologizes for not being able to join you today, but I will try to update you on how the recovery process after Hurricane Fiona is going. So far, there's been over 1.2 million applications for FEMA aid. There's one more week to apply for aid. That deadline is coming very soon, November 21st. So far, over 700,000 applications have been approved. However, most of that aid is in the form of critical needs assistance. That's the one-time payment of $700 for basic needs right after the disaster, the hurricane this time. Obviously not nearly enough for people to repair their homes. We run a helpline for people to aid people on this FEMA, to help people go through this FEMA process. And we've been able to identify some issues that we are afraid might make it impossible for some people to get aid. In the application process itself, we pointed out before, there's some issues regarding language, specifically the presence of staff that does not speak Spanish or speak Spanish as a second language, but not at a level enough that they can communicate with the people requesting aid on issues so technical as this, as home ownership or damages. Inspectors have been a very common cause for these problems. The first inspectors coming out don't seem to all of them be fully bilingual or fully fluent in Spanish. We've also seen a lot of denial so far. We're starting to see very strong wave of denegations and the need to present an appeal for people that did not get aid. As some of you may know, For Hurricane Maria, FEMA denied about 70% of the applications submitted. We're not at that number yet, but we're definitely seeing a lot of denials and some of the same problems that we saw during Hurricane Maria. For instance, there's a lot of problems regarding ownership or formal title. Even though FEMA originally said that they will not be taking ownership requirements, that they will not be requiring a formal title for people to get aid. That's a common cause for denial so far. An inspector saying to people that they will not accept documents, especially if they're not notarized as a form of an alternative form to prove ownership. We've also seen a lot of denials, far more than we saw from Maria, that people are being denied because they did not get flood insurance after getting aid after Hurricane Maria. There's some numbers on how many people have flood insurance in Puerto Rico, and that's actually under 4% is the estimate. The preliminary damage assessment actually mentioned that less than 1% of the people affected have flood insurance. And considering that the main damages that were caused by Hurricane Fiona were due to the rain, we suspect and we fear that that may be a huge cause for denials this time around. Finally, I wanted to point out that a lot of those FEMA decisions don't have full determinations. People are being denied, but not all the sources of aid are being listed in the decision. So people don't get some of the assistance. For instance, they got assistance for their personal property, but it doesn't say anything about their housing damages, and they're not given an explanation of why they're not eligible for aid. Go. I think that's where we are right now. I don't know if anyone has a question on this.
I'll just, number one, thank you, of course, for that excellent update. I'd say, so a question just about the letters. Let's start there. So when you appeal, just for folks that might not know, so when you appeal a denial of assistance from FEMA, you know, you need to appeal all reasons for the denial. So how would a survivor go about accessing, you know, all the reasons if it is not in the letter that they were sent when informed that they were denied, if that makes any sense?
Our first recommendation would be to call FEMA, and sometimes they won't put it on writing, but they will tell you over the phone. But even sometimes that doesn't help. They tell you to assume that if you didn't get a notification that you were denied. And you basically have to guess as of why. Sometimes you can help them look through the documents they submitted, what the problem might have been. The most common reason seems to be that they think there's insufficient damage to the home, so they will not be eligible for aid. But it's definitely a big problem of access to justice and access to a remedy if you don't know where you're actually appealing.
Yeah, right. And even if you're calling FEMA on the phone, then and there's, you know, been ongoing issues with translation services and things like that, right? Like, you know, that's just another barrier to all of that.
And not only the wait, because you have to wait for a translator, and then what the person actually changed, something that we have seen, we saw in Maria and we see again, that sometimes depending on who answers the phone, you might get slightly different information. Someone might tell you, I cannot tell you what the reason is. Some people will tell you some of the reasons and not all of it, because the process is not meant for it to be done through the phone.
Yeah. I'll also just ask, you know, how much of this is new issues? I don't know if you, you know, were working in the same role or a similar role following Hurricane Maria, but, you know, how many of these things are repeats? You know, how many of these things were things that FEMA, had already been notified about, but had not been addressed?
Oh, yes. I actually was here during Hurricane Maria. Ownership is something that we've talked a lot. We actually raised these issues to FEMA, and we developed a sworn statement that people could use as a model to present as an alternative form of ownership that FEMA said that would that they would accept. They have refused to give it to people that so they can do it. So they just send them or tell them to call us to get it, which then creates a problem because there's 1 million applications and there's a staff of 15 here trying to handle it. But that one's, that's well known, the issue of no determination, that was very well known. The flood issue is no, we did not see this port, at least not as frequently during Maria. The people that were denied because they did not comply for the flood insurance. I should clarify on the ownership issue that anyone who doesn't have a formal title to their home, there could be an ownership that wasn't divided up. It could be someone that rescued land and built their own home without owning it. In Puerto Rico, there's lack of data. There's lack of data for everything, actually. But there are estimates that say that up to 50% of the population does not have formal title, ownership or formal title to, over their homes.
Gotcha. Well, thank you so much, Veronica, as always, for your work and all your compatriots at Iota Legal's work on all these issues. And I'm sure I'll talk to all of y'all very soon.
Thank you.
Cool. I'll just snag the next slide. Yeah, that's me again. Hello, Noah Patton, as a policy analyst for disaster recovery at the National Low Income Housing Coalition. I'll take the next slide. Yep. Yeah, so this is kind of our, I'm not going to say year end because there's always something that pops up, but this is a large year end ask for all of you listening. This, of course, is a brief summary of the Reforming Disaster Recovery Act of 2021. It's a bipartisan bill that would permanently authorize the Community Development Block Grant Disaster Recovery Program, which is, of course, the only source for long-term disaster recovery funds from the federal government. The bill would permanently authorize the program. Right now, it gets periodically has money approved for it. And now each time money is approved for it, then HUD has to kind of essentially rewrite the regs for the program, which of course slows all those funds down and makes it more likely that funds might go to folks that were, that funds will be diverted away from folks that were the most impacted by a disaster. And it has a bunch of additional excellent targeting, data transparency, civil rights and housing, mitigation, resiliency measures in it. And I'll just take the next slide. Yeah, so the actual ask here is that you and your organization, for all everybody listening in, to go to that link in the chat and or that Sydney will be putting in the chat, and sign on to a letter asking Congress to attach that bill to a year-end package, whatever that package may be. Of course, this bill has been broadly endorsed by both Republicans and Democrats. Recent survey by the Bipartisan Policy Center found that 97% of CDBGDR grantees supported permanent authorization. So, you know, we're pushing strong ahead of a change, a new Congress next year, in order to get this into law so that we can kind of, it's a first hack at that systemic change that I think Maddie Sloan was talking about a little bit earlier today. So please do sign on, and thanks so much. We do have a full slate of additional disaster housing recovery programs coming up, and I think that might be the last slide. On the last slide. Ooh. Yeah, so feel free to join us, Disaster Recovery Working Group, Wednesdays at 2 p.m. And for all these good stuff, that's our kind of general schedule. And I will talk to y'all soon, if not before. So thanks so much, everybody. And thanks again to all our excellent speakers today.
Thank you.
Thank you, Noah.
Thank you, Noah.
Thanks all.